Hello, this is Niswander, and you're watching the Now Man Show. Robert Scheer is an award-winning journalist and the editor-in-chief of the online magazine Truth Dig. He is a USC professor at the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, co-hosts the radio program Left, Right, and Center on KCRW-FM in Los Angeles. In the 1960s, he served as the Vietnam correspondent, became the editor-in-chief of Ramparts magazine, reporting from Asia, Latin America, and the Middle East. While in Cuba, he interviewed Fidel Castro. In the late 60s, he ran for Congress, and he's interviewed U.S. presidents from Richard Nixon to Bill Clinton. Robert Scheer calls the Los Angeles Times home for 17 years as a reporter and a columnist, and his most recent book is called They Know Everything About You, How Data Collecting Corporations and Snooping Government Agencies Are Destroying Democracy. Robert Scheer, welcome to the Now Man Show.
Hi.
Now, let's go back to the very beginning. You were a war correspondent.
By the way, can I correct the introduction
yes.
a little?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I was doing Left, Right, and Center at KCRW and carried on NPR, and I did it for 19 years.
Wow.
And now I do a program called Scheer Intelligence. With my son Josh Scheer, who's also on KPFK, so just put that there. And my time at the LA Times was 29 years, not 17, but that's okay, who's counting?
Wow, years are just incredible experiences there.
And, and
going back to the beginning, I mean, you must have been a young man in Asia reporting on the Vietnam War. What do you have any memorable moments or stories that stand out in your mind still after all these years? Or,
well, what's memorable is the human suffering that our government brought about. You know, Barack Obama was just in Laos, and I should explain. I was a graduate student at Berkeley, and in the summer of '60, I went to Cuba because I was supposed to be in Center for Chinese Studies, and I couldn't get into Communist China. I thought, well, I'll go see what's happening in Cuba. And then I ended up not doing, having such a happy experience at the end of my graduate, because I perished publishing. I wrote a book with a great guy named Marie Seitlin, who ended up being a professor at UCLA, on U.S.-Cuban relations called Cuban-American Tragedy. Penguin published at Grove Press. And my department wasn't that happy with it, so I ended up selling books at City Likes Books for Lawrence Ferlinghetti in 63. And while I was there, I started reading about Vietnam, mostly in French periodicals, English, and this was early 60s. And I realized this is getting to be a big mess, so I wanted to know more about it and went over to the Cal Library, read about it, and so forth. And you know, we, Madam New came to San Francisco. I helped organize a demonstration urging that the U.S. not get further involved with the Diem government, which was basically a Catholic-oriented government in Vietnam, left over from French colonialism, but 90% of the people were Buddhists, and the whole thing wasn't going to work on any level. But also, you had this popular guy named Ho Chi Minh in the north, and you weren't going to, as General Eisenhower, President Eisenhower pointed out, if there had been a fair election at any time, he would have gotten 80% of the vote no matter what you did. So the whole thing was a phony from the beginning. And it was heating up again in 63, and I read about it and went over to Cal Library. And it's interesting about investigative journalism, which we romanticize, but this is one of my big stories, and it was quite by, well, I wouldn't say by accident, you have to read. A package of papers there in the Cal Library that some guy who had been involved in something called the Michigan State Vietnam Project, he had died, his widow, and he had died a natural death, but he'd been in Vietnam, and as it turned out, being a front for the CIA, that's what this Michigan State Police Project was. Well, his widow had just donated these papers, and one of them had a package with a ribbon around it, and I opened it up. Nobody had ever read it. And it had all the details of how we trained the police in Saigon, including in torture, and how to, you know, beat the Viet Cong and arrest anybody who dissented from the Diem government, as I say, and also torture them. So I set about investigating that. And just by coincidence, a great Angelino died last week, Stanley Sheinbaum.
Yes.
Who some people know because he was head of the police commission that fired Darrell Gates in the 1990s after the Rodney King thing, but he also was a guy who went and tried to work on peace in the Mideast.
And didn't he finance the Ellsberg trials
as well? He raised the money for the Ellsberg trial, yeah. Married to a great woman, Betty, one of Sheinbaum, who's still with us in 96, just like Stanley. I think, yeah. I got her age right.
Wow.
95 or 96.
And she's a daughter of Jack Warner,
the Warner
brothers.
She was the daughter of Harry Warner.
Harry Warner.
She was terrific. I shouldn't say, but she's a terrific person.
Yeah.
On her own, I've always felt guided by Betty, and she was somebody who was influenced by the Hollywood 10 and the struggles going back way then, before she had met Stanley. But anyway, you asked about how I got to be involved with Vietnam, and mm-hmm. then I got these papers, and I wanted to know more about this, and I set about to interview people. And none of them would talk to me, these professors and people who had all been used as a cover for the yeah. CIA, until I got the co-director of the project, a guy in the United States, Stanley Sheinbaum. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. that's how we met. I met him when he became a whistleblower. He was the only one involved with the project who said, yeah, it was terrible. And then I showed him what I had learned about it, and he was more deeply offended by it. And first, I wrote an article for Paul Krasner, the Realist magazine, which was terrific little publication back then. And then I got involved with Ramparts magazine, which was a Catholic literary quarterly at that time, Warren Hinkle.
Oh, yeah, Catholic. Also I didn't realize that.
A Catholic,
yeah,
very much. Yeah. So influenced by Pope John, Patrimon Terrace, encyclical. And also the farm workers, Cesar Chavez was Catholic, and Dolores Huerta and others. So Catholic Church had a progress, still, obviously, with the current Pope,
yeah.
has a progressive impulse when you take Jesus seriously.
That's right.
And his teaching. So, you know, Ramparts was very much an outgrowth of that. They were the only ones willing to print my story because it zeroed in on the role of the Catholic Church in the United States because of the Catholic base of Nguyen Diem, the dictator in South Vietnam. And then Paul Krasner, the Realist, I went to see him. We were walking around in Greenwich Village, and I said, you know, there's this country, Vietnam, it's about to heat up, and I got this article, and gave him my article. I said, you gotta help me get there. And he said, well, what do I gotta do? And I said, well, for $1,350.76, I can go right now to that travel agency and get myself a ticket. I think it was one way, it might have been round trip, I don't know. He had just made money, because he didn't have any money, but he had just made money doing some really great thing. He came out with these posters. You remember, this was now the early 60s, and Lenny Bruce mm-hmm. was going to jail for saying, you know, the word. So Krasner, ever the genius here, comic genius, figured out he would make red, white, and blue bumper strips and posters with stars and, you know, red, white, and blue, and that said, communism.
Wow.
So the kids in the dorms were buying these posters and everything, and what was the dorm leader is going to say? No, I'm going to throw you out of school.
Right, exactly.
And then you'll say, well, don't you want to communism? You know, it was, yeah. became very patriotic. And so, anyway, he had some extra money from selling these things, so he paid for my ticket to go to Vietnam. And just to bring the story up to the present, a few weeks ago, before we're taping this, I guess it was 2 weeks ago, Barack Obama was the first American president to visit Laos.
Oh, really?
And Hillary Clinton had visited as Secretary of State in 2012. But Barack Obama went, and it was a good thing to do, to go and acknowledge the terrible damage that we've done to this country. But he came out with this statistic that is very accurate, unfortunately, that we dropped during this war in Indochina, we dropped more bombs on this country of Laos, not mm-hmm, including mm-hmm. Vietnam and not including Cambodia, mm-hmm. Laos,
yes.
Than we had dropped on Germany and Japan in all of World War II.
Really?
So you got to think, I mean, if you ever just dwell on one statistic, you can dwell on that one. Here is the most powerful country in the world, drop more bombs on this truly primitive, economically primitive country of Laos, okay? I mean, Vietnam yes. had a complex civilization.
And, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, Cambodia had a long history of building dykes and, you know, mm-hmm. Siem Reap and, you know, Angkor Wat and all that. But Laos, which I visited at that time in 64, was, you know, a cut-off, landlocked, rural country of, you know, I don't like to use the word primitive because they had an exquisite culture by their standards and in their terms. But, you know, the example I use, I could go into a village in Laos, as I did, with pencils as a gift. A pencil would delight a child because I hadn't been able to use one or get one or see one. And these are the people we're dropping bombs on, fragmentation bombs, you know, the kind that we're now still digging up.
And the landmines, yeah. I've been a media ambassador for Adopt a Minefield, so I know what you're talking about.
Well, and you know, they still are killing people in Laos and Cambodia and Vietnam. And for me, you know, that was all I needed to know. I mean, here were people, they couldn't threaten anybody. You know, I mean, they had no air force.
That's
they
right.
had nothing. You know,
well, so what was the real agenda?
Well, the real agenda was to make water feed your arms industry. The real agenda was some kind of global conception of your battle against communism, but communism was never monolithic. So at the time I was in Laos, you know, the Chinese and Russians were shooting at each, Soviets were
That's
shooting
right.
at each other across the border. So the whole thing was phony, crazy,
yes.
But very sensible, well-educated people would defend it. Oh no, the Ho Chi Minh Trail goes near here, so forth. And then I went back a year later with Stanley Sheinbaum after I'd written about his involvement, and he had been in the Air Force during World War II doing maps and so forth, or aerial reconnaissance. And so we got an airplane from the Cambodian government, Prince Sihanouk, and some people flew us around looking this area for the Ho Chi Minh Trail and could show it was a fraud, this whole excuse for all this bombing. But that's how I got involved with that issue. And Ramparts magazine by that time was willing to pick up some of the cost of my doing this, that the realist, and that's how I became first their Southeast Asia correspondent, and then at the end of the day, after Warren Hinkle left, I became the editor-in-chief. But I worked very closely with a guy named Dougal Sturman, the great art director, one of the greatest of all time, who designed that magazine so we could be on the newsstands and look like, we even gave Pan Am a free ad for the back of the magazine so we would look like every other magazine, and they sued us.
Oh, wow.
They didn't want to be associated with us. We had we just took the
same ad. So you were being adbusters before adbusters.
Yeah, and then, but we ran a lot of good stories, and we had Major Sergeant Don Duncan, who died some years ago, 10 years ago, but he was a highly decorated Special Forces guy, and he came out against the war describers. Ramparts did great reporting on all that, and so that's how my journalism started. And
that's fantastic.
Continued,
And you actually interviewed at 5 American presidents? Richard Nixon, Gerald Ford, Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan.
I interviewed them when they were on their way to becoming president, or in the case of Nixon, after he'd been president. I interviewed Nixon in 84 when he was holed up in New York. And he was writing some good books about the need for detente. And he, by today's standard, Nixon seems very rational and somewhat decent even.
Wow.
I mean, if you think about it, you know, he actually did the opening to China. We're
That's
in the
true.
Business of demonizing people, whether it's a Democrat or Republican running this nation now. We demonize everyone around the world. But Vladimir Putin, we now describe him like he's another Hitler. You know, we the government of Syria, wow, we've got to overthrow them. Gaddafi, the defanged dictator of Libya, who was coming really back to accommodation with the U.S.
It was relatively stable for decades.
Yeah, we involved in, now we have, Libya is this big mess, yet we accommodate Saudi Arabia, which is, if there's one country that's responsible for terrorism and grief and everything in the world, it's Saudi Arabia. You know, the connections are quite clear of certainly money and influence, and 15 of the 19 hijackers came from Saudi Arabia. Bin Laden was from Saudi Arabia. And yet we managed to pick a fight with everybody else in the world and still coddle Saudi Arabia. So you don't have adults watching the story. That's what something I learned as a very young person. And so in terms of interviewing these presidents, I wrote a book called Playing President, the Kashuk books, if anybody wants to look at it. I interviewed Well, Nixon after he was in, but I interviewed Ronald Reagan. I interviewed Ronald Reagan before he was governor of California.
Oh, really, man?
I got along with him quite well. I mean, my whole thing as a journalist is what we tell kids, keep your listening ears on. There's no reason for you, for the two of us to be talking if you already got everything figured out, and if I already got everything figured out.
Exactly.
If we're not a work in progress.
That's right.
And if we can't change and think and be influenced, what's the... There's no point to this exercise. So what's the sense of my talking to Ronald Reagan if I can't get myself psyched up to think, you know, maybe he's got something, maybe he knows something that I don't see.
That's right.
He sees it. You know, even Donald Trump right now. Okay, why do we have to understand Donald? You got to understand Donald Trump because you, otherwise you're not going to understand why almost half of the American people are thinking about voting for him.
That's right.
You know, then if you don't understand their anger, their frustration, and if you dismiss them the way Hillary Clinton did, you know, then you're not getting the real tragedy in this country. Those people feel abandoned. They feel ripped off by the economic system and trade agreements and so forth. So when I went to interview Reagan when he was running for governor and against Pat Brown, who had been a big popular Democrat, but now he wasn't, so I want to know what's this guy got?
You exactly. Know? What does he have to say about the issues?
And how does he think? And he was certainly no simpleton. He started out as a Democrat. His father had worked for the New Deal. He'd had a life. You know, he'd run a labor union, the Screen Actors Guild.
That's right.
And all the ways of demeaning him, you know, I've always resented this idea if somebody's an actor, then they're not smart. You know, we have gotten, you know, Paul Newman was very smart and a great political person.
Mike Farrell
right now. Mike Farrell is probably the most useful political observer we have. I think he's fighting to get rid of the death penalty. It's on the ballot here in California. He's fought the good fight for criminal justice and fairness. He's just human rights around the world.
And you have Oliver Stone.
Oliver Stone.
You know, who's got the new Snowden film out, which reminds me, your latest book is about... surveillance.
Yeah, I don't know. Hopefully, I know Oliver read it, and I liked Snowden a lot. I went and saw it the other night.
How was it?
And
did you
I think it's a terrific movie because it the whole thing is they want to dismiss. Now you got a guy. We're in Pasadena. You got Adam Schiff is the local congressman from here.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say that SOB. That SOB. Okay. Let's not mince words. I actually supported that guy. I spoke at All Saints Church and other places and here in Pasadena. I said, well, he's better than, I forget, his opponent and everything, you know. Well, this guy's been on the Intelligence Committee of the House. He's the leading Democrat on the Intelligence Committee. You find one single thing that Adam Schiff ever revealed about what our government was doing about spying on us and on the rest of the world.
Yeah.
Find one bit of information that he ever shared with his constituents about government overreach, violation of the Fourth Amendment, even stuff that, you know, Supreme Court Justice Roberts has criticized the government doing, you know, the conservative
justice. Yes, exactly.
You know, this guy supported the Patriot Act. Well, you got all these Republicans teamed up with a lot of Democrats to sunset the Patriot Act as a violation of our freedom. So you got this guy posing as some kind of liberal here in Pasadena, your town, where we're recording right now.
Yeah.
And he condemns Edward Snowden, says he's got to come back and face the music. He's, you know, he uses his word about it. He weakened us. He betrayed our troops. He did all this. Really? Who did it? The guy, the people who lied us into wars that cannot be justified, who hid behind national security? You know, and you're going to tell me that Edward Snowden weakened this country by telling us what the founders said we had to know about what our government is up to, what are they doing, when they lie to us, when they tell us the truth? You know, so here you got a guy who's got all the clearances, the top Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee, and they issue a unanimous report trying to destroy Snowden. You say, oh, he didn't really break his legs when he was training to be in Special Forces. He had shin splints, and the doctors told him, you can't stay in.
Well, do you think that there could be an agenda to use the surveillance state to intimidate the public?
Oh, come on. What are we talking about? Yeah. This is what our founders warned us about. Look, if you read nothing else, go read George Washington's farewell address.
Wow.
You know, that old commie, that old subversive George Washington, all right? And you read his farewell address, which he prepared very carefully because he thought he was going to be a one-term president.
Right,
and he was writing that thing, working on it. And, you know, obviously we didn't have radio or television. He was going to give it as like a wall poster, or, you know, the way they did Declaration of Independence. And he passed it around to other folks, you know, other founders.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he put it in the desk because he stayed for a second term, and then that's the farewell address. And that farewell address is a warning against the military-industrial complex that is exactly consistent with General Eisenhower, another great general, in his farewell address. Why we don't know that, why it's not, sorry.
Oh, sorry about that.
I'm going to make a contribution to your program, get you in the chair. Why that's not studied, I have to, every time I bring it up, I have to go and research, did I make this up?
Yeah.
You know, is there a George Washington farewell?
Right,
yes.
Right.
And in that farewell address, he says, pursue international, he's not an isolationist, international relations, trade, commerce, pursue it by gentle means. Mm. Do not expect favors, do not give favors, gentle means. And he warns about the impostures of pretended patriotism. If there are any three words that we need to understand the essential hope of the American experiment, beware the impostures of pretended patriotism. Sorry, four words.
Wow.
You know, and that's what we've been suffering from, pretended patriotism. They use patriotism to lie us into a war in Iraq. They use patriotism to do drone attacks on children. They use patriotism to demonize Putin or anybody in the country who won't go snap to our fingers, you know. They have used the war on terror to gain a degree of power and observation over the American people that no dictator ever had because of modern technology. That's what's happened. And they, you know, and in alliance with our domestic companies, or international, multinational companies that gather this data, and a public that gives all this data off because, hey, yeah, let me Yelp the restaurant and let me find this.
Yeah,
you can
exactly.
Have every bit of personal data. You can go on Amazon and buy a book, and then Amazon will tell you, you stop reading this on page 43. And, you know, oh, it was Lady Chatterley's Lover by D.H. Lawrence. Hey,
yes.
Maybe you're some kind of pervert.
Yeah.
Now, here's Amazon, which, by the way, Jeff Bezos, the guy who made all his money, you know, he owns the Washington Post.
Yeah,
Washington
yeah.
Post printed Snowden's material,
yes.
Right, along with The Guardian.
Yes.
Now the Washington Post had an editorial condemning Snowden. No, he's got to come back and face the music. Well, why do they, if we have freedom of the press, and he gave them the information that they printed, why does that protect the Washington Post and not Snowden?
Well,
same
you know,
thing happened with the Pentagon Papers.
Yes, that's right.
You know, Daniel Ellsberg. If freedom of the press protects that paper that's going to make money off these
right.
stories,
right.
why doesn't it protect the whistleblower? Okay, that's the key thing in the Snowden case. If the information Snowden gave the American public is information that should have not been classified, that we had a right to see, that we needed to see to be an informed public,
right.
Where do you get off Adam Schiff? Where do you get off Jeff Bezos in the Washington Post saying he should be in the slammer like Chelsea Manning for the rest of her life in the slammer for giving? What was Chelsea Manning's big crime? To reveal that our pilots were shooting up innocent civilians,
yes.
that they were shooting up journalists, including reporters for Reuters, that's the great crime. So what we're really, you got under Barack Obama now, a president who has used the Espionage Act more than all those previous presidents combined.
Yes.
In direct violation of this warning from George Washington, beware the impostures of pretended patriotism. In the name of patriotism, you know, you are willing to destroy the Fourth Amendment, the First Amendment, all of our protections. Now, why do we have those protections? No one ever stops to ask. Are they a luxury just in safe times?
That's right.
Are they something you just have written down because it sounds nice? No. The founding fathers, whatever their other failures, and they were failures.
Yes.
You know,
we're all human.
No, but also white, male, privileged, yes, all that we
exactly.
know. But what did they do? They enshrined a notion of limited government, checks and balances, the right of the individual, they enshrined that, right? Knowing it would be used against them.
Yep.
They were going to be the government.
Yeah.
So, you know, they knew the press could be nasty. We had pretty nasty press. You know, the town crier, the wall posters, you know, penny press, the pamphleteers, you know, Tom Paine, they didn't like Tom Paine. He could roast them, you know.
Yeah, that's right, even though it was common sense.
Yeah, but they protected his right. And the right of anybody,
that's right.
Free speech, right to people assemble, free press. Why? Because they said that will bring discomfort to us rulers, leaders, elected people. But we need to be made uncomfortable. Why? Because their maxim was power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely.
That's right.
And so it was not for the best of times. No, it was for the worst of times. Because those founders knew, hey, this thing could go south. We could be hanging from the nearest tree. The Brits come back, as they did in 1812.
Well, we also know from the Princeton study in 2014, you know, after studying something like 180 bills and policies from 81 to 2001, that the conclusions were 100% oligarchy. They didn't find anything in those bills or those policies that was democratic. Yeah. So basically, you have a handful of people making all the decisions, all the important decisions for everyone else. And George Carlin used to say, we don't have any choices. Well, you can choose what kind of yogurt flavor or cereal, but you don't really have any choices. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, it's really, well, so obviously true. And, yeah. And the main point to make about choices, we used to have those pictures when we were celebrating our bringing democracy to Iraq with the overthrow of Saddam Hussein, who had nothing to do with 9/11, and Al-Qaeda couldn't operate in Iraq. So it's maybe the biggest or clearest lie in U.S. foreign policy history. You use the attack of 9/11 as justification to go war in Iraq, and that's the one place where Al-Qaeda couldn't operate, and you know, he had nothing to do with it. They had nothing to do with it. So yet when we were bringing democracy, supposedly, you show these women and, you know, they're in their chador or whatever, and they're holding up their purple stained finger because they had voted, right?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
I voted. Well, they all voted for what the Ayatollah had told them or
exactly.
Some other tribal leader or something had told them. Well, is that what you mean by democracy? Well, how are we different?
That's
if
right.
You're making a decision about a president who took us to this war and engaged in policies of torture and lied to us, and you don't have access to the information, right? Like that was what Daniel Ellsberg did with the Pentagon Papers. Said, no, I worked on this history within the Pentagon about the Vietnam War, and I see it's a tissue of lies.
Mm-hmm.
The American people have been deceived. Now, this is an ex-Marine,
yep,
Daniel
yep.
Ellsberg, you know, had supported the war. He said, well, it's all lies. I got to let the people know. I got to take this to the Washington Post and New York, the first New York Times, then the Washington Post, get it out there. Well, he faced 130 years in jail, you know,
right.
under Nixon. So here you have now the same lies. So the vote means nothing. The vote means nothing if they can keep the basic information, whether it's about trade agreements or it's about going to war.
Yep.
If you don't have the information, an uninformed vote doesn't mean anything.
That's right.
It's a parody, right? And that's what you're really talking about now. And these idiots that go around saying, oh, lesser evil, let's take a little break. No, before you. Oh,
okay.
You want to
We're down to 30 seconds. So let's take a little break and come back in another segment and continue
Let me take my 30 seconds.
Okay.
And cut it out. I just want to say the lesser evil, that's a big cop out because the people who brought this country to misery right now with wars that can't be justified, with an economy that raped the average American for the interests of Wall Street, they were the establishment. It wasn't Donald Trump. It was establishment that Hillary Clinton and her husband played a very central role in. And they can't cop out now and say, oh, there's somebody worse. Yeah, he's worse, but so what? You created the mess.
Thank you very much, Robert Scheer. This is Niswander on the Now Man Show. To be continued.